Saturday. Christmas comes early.
Unbelievable!
Welcome to this incredible scene.
Bills.
To the end zone!
Chargers.
It's a touchdown!
An exclusive NFL game.
That's fantastic!
Live in primetime.
Wow!
Only on Peacock.
With a Christmas gift to their fans.
They're having some fun now.
Bills versus Chargers. Saturday, 7:30 Eastern. Exclusively on Peacock.
This episode is brought to you by Google Pixel, the official fan phone of the NBA and WNBA. The new Pixel 8 and Pixel 8 Pro are built different. How? Take the Audio Magic Eraser tool. It helps block out distracting crowd noise so your play-by-play commentary sounds crystal clear. The only phone engineered by Google brings out the audio you care about so your videos sound as crisp as they look. Learn more at googlestore.com/PixelNBA. Audio Magic Eraser requires Google Photos app. May not work on all audio elements. Apple Gift Card is a practical gift that unlocks a world of entertainment and fun. You can send it via email or give a physical card to your loved ones. Your friends and family can spend it on their favorite Apple services, including Apple subscriptions. Apple Gift Card can be used to buy all things Apple. Products, accessories, apps, games, movies, TV shows, iCloud Plus, and more. Visit apple.com for details and to send Apple Gift Cards to your friends and family this holiday season.
This episode is brought to you by State Farm. From your morning podcast to your afternoon playlist, State Farm knows you personalize your entire day, and that's why State Farm helps you personalize your insurance with the State Farm Personal Price Plan. It offers coverage options that help protect what you care about most at an affordable price just for you. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. Prices vary by state. Options selected by customer. Availability and eligibility may vary.
Welcome back to another episode of Keeping Current with Kansas City. This is Thad Bell from the Kansas City Soccer Journal. With me, as always, Daniel Sperry from the Kansas City Star. How are you tonight, sir?
Doing good, man. How are you?
Not bad. That was a little slow, man. You got to be faster on the uptake there.
It was a little slow. Honestly, it's because on Zoom here, the message popped up and I was like, I don't know if I can just like start talking without clicking got it that Thad's recording right now. So
Okay.
I'm tired, dude. It was a long weekend. It really was.
It was, man.
We got another,
it's been a long couple weeks.
I don't say a long weekend. Yeah. We had a home game on Sunday night last week, a home game on Tuesday night, a home game on Saturday, and a home game on Sunday. I still didn't get out to any of the trainings this week in person because of day job stuff. So, yeah, man, it's been a heck of a week, but ready to talk some current, right? The best soccer team in Kansas City at the moment.
The only one consistently scoring goals. All right. Since last time, I think we officially...
Alvid all has scored in like four straight for SKC2, so...
Yeah, but he's the only one. So... SKC2 was doing really good, but they have kind of cooled off a little bit with a couple losses now. So...
Yep.
All right. Last time we talked was after the big coaching change. And there has been three games since then. Challenge Cup and two league games.
Yeah.
All 2-0 victories.
All of them with Cassie Miller in net.
Yep. So the question is...
I'm just stating facts.
it is a fact. The question is, though, is it due to Cassie starting? Is it due to the coaching change? Is it due to perhaps having DeBigna and Vanessa DiBernardo in the midfield? I think those are all factors.
They're all factors. One more than others, for sure.
Which one would you see as the biggest factor?
It's Stepinian Vanessa DiBernardo, 100%. I think there's some nice tweaks that have been made by Caroline Herbloom, and I don't think we can ignore that. I think Cassie Miller has also been good in goal. She hasn't really had to face a lot of difficult chances, however, but I think she's been very good at like preemptively taking care of things that could be dicey that it seemed like AD would traditionally stay on her line for. So I think that's a bit of a difference there for why Cassie's been solid and has been in there. Like I said, Herbloom has made some good adjustments. I think they're a little bit more patient in possession, and it's shown when they do get the ball back that they are quick to goal, but they are safer, smarter, quick to goal. But you really can't ignore Dabinia and Vanessa DiBernardo's impact in slowing down and holding up the midfield. Not holding, slowing down in a way of like, oh, they're dragging everyone down, but in a way of collectively helping the play breathe. And there's calm and great decision making being made, especially by Lowe in a deeper position. As well as Vanessa has been really good, really patient. So yeah, I think those it can't be ignored that they're the other two factors, but when you insert Dabinia and Dabinia at the level that she's been at in these last 3 games, really, that's really honestly, Dabinia has been really good for the last 4 games. That game against Chicago, I think the score line doesn't really justify how well they played throughout a majority of that match, and I've said that plenty of times. But Dabinia's been excellent, superb in her 4 starts this season. She has 4 goals, and I believe an assist. I may be wrong. You can come after me if I'm wrong there. But overall, Dabinia has been stupid good this year, and so has Lowe. So and Vanessa now. So I think that's it. It's the midfield, right? Has to be.
I think that's the biggest factor by far. When she was in there in the previous game, I mean, and coming back off of injury, and they had a limited amount of starts, or the limited amount of time to play in Chicago, they were better. And that's why they signed those two players in free agency. They still have players yet to bring in that they signed in free agency, but that's the biggest factor. I'm not trying to dismiss anything that Coach Caroline has done. I'm calling her that. I think she's made, like you said, some nice tweaks. I think she's has some changes that will be coming into play more and more as the season goes on, and especially as other players become available. But that's not necessarily saying that Coach Potter wouldn't have done similar things. Even that first win, they basically went right with the same game plan they had already, except for Haley Mace being sick, so they swapped her out.
Yeah. I am if we want to look more at some of the things that Herbloom has brought in, I think there's a like if you look at the passing maps, and I don't know how much you look at that, but after the match, I think Ariel Dreor, who is with American Soccer Analysis, posts those regularly. And I always was so shocked at how little connectivity there was within the Potter passing map. And this one was a pretty good kaleidoscope. You can see the distribution lines, of Gabby Robinson, Gabrielle Robinson to Vanessa, Croy in the middle of this of the back three to Lowe, and Addie in the back three to Kate Delfava at that point, who was pinched up kind of higher and actually a little bit central for a decent amount of the game. Very hybrid-y back four or back three at times from that back line, especially when Kate pinched inside. But overall, you can see the way the ball is moving, the distribution, There's a gigantic line between Lo Labonta and Dabinia and CeCe Kaiser, and that was something that they were trying to hit was, play Dabinia, play behind, play the late run that, that Gotham wasn't picking up. And I think we obviously Gotham's fresh in our mind, but I think looking at the passing map from that game, it just has become a little bit clearer in the overall pass and move and pass and move and the game plan from that aspect, instead of at times being very quick to go forward, and it surpassed a lot of the passing options that were there. And I thought it was interesting because Potter would admit that some of the they were not taking the extra pass at times, or that there were options there that they weren't that were available that weren't being played, but it never got fixed. And I think that was something to me that's like, is that a byproduct of the Potter system, that those options are there and the players are so focused on doing something else that they aren't recognizing those moments? Because just taking it down a notch has actually allowed them to play even quicker forward and more dynamic and accurate forward, by taking the time in the buildup to build the right scenario where they can spring that ball and get vertical really quick.
I always felt last couple, well, last year under Potter that yes, they were trying to play the ball too quickly, and there was whole games I would sit there and count how many passes would be connected, and there would be one good pass, the second one would be astray or intercepted. And I think there was a game last year that I counted like five times that they connected two passes together, and they won that game. Because one of those turned into a goal, or two of them turned into a goal. It was incredible that their passing was that lacking last year. And I do think that's not as much a feature of Potter's system as it was a feature of the players they had playing in the game at that point.
I think that's fair too, because I mean, we barely know life with Dabinia and DiBernardo under Potter. And so you don't get to see the full aspect. And obviously, I think, like I said, he noted as well that those opportunities were there in build-up that weren't getting taken. And I think those are so it's not like he was blind to it. It just never got fixed. And maybe you're right. It could have been just personnel. But that's what happens when, last year you have Desiree Scott there, but you're at without Sam Mewis, without Lynn Williams, all of a sudden there's a significant creative force in the midfield that is heavily relied upon Lowe to be that Dabinia in those moments. And
It's not
I
her
won't say
strong
that's
suit.
not, yeah, and I think she can do it, and I will never tell her she can't do anything, but
Not to her face.
not to her face, she'll punch me, and I would probably deserve it, Lowe, if you're listening. All respect, but it does suit. Like there are so many times last year where in moments where she was deep lying and she picked out these passes to CeCe over the top, and you look at the assist to Dabinia, is almost the same thing that they've done. CeCe's been on the end of that at least two or three times. I think Kristen Hamilton was on the end of a pass like that multiple times last year, and now Dabinia is the one that's getting on the end of it. And we can go deeper into the Gotham game too if we want, because I noticed how much they were picking on the second runner through the Gotham line. And it was funny because the first runner would go and they would be offside, but they would just it's a very good Pep Guardiola-ish tactic where the first runner goes through, they're offside, but they at least drop the line a little bit because they have to do that. And then as that line drops, the secondary runner is the one where the ball gets played in behind. They smack. I don't know how many times last night Gotham players were raising their hands for offside when the run came from behind that player raising their hand for offside with their back turned when the ball was played, because they weren't checking the runners coming through the back line, and the midfield wasn't checking them, and they were going unnoticed. And having players like Lowe, who can drop the dime like that from deep, and DiBernardo as well, that, and I mean, at some point, I think Alex Loera can be back in the mix whenever Loera can be back in the mix when she gets her foot back healthy and healed and is off the scoot. When that happens, she's got a great ball from deep. And we saw it in the assist to CeCe Kaiser for that goal against Portland earlier in the year. She leveled a few assists last year too. Her set piece delivery, she's the one that's been on corner kicks too, so she's got a good long ball over the top like that too. And I don't think that that necessarily makes the current a route one team, but it makes them so dangerous to stretch teams that way, and sooner or later teams are going to start sagging off, and then now you're just allowing Dibinha and all those players space to create and run.
It's cool. Catching back up for a second, I want to go back to what we were talking about a minute ago, though. Being more calm on the ball when they were signing these free agents of Vanessa and Morgan Gautreau, that was, I think, one of our first things was they're going to be calmer on the ball. They're going to be more a little more patient in the buildup, which that's one of those things, slow is smooth, smooth is fast. So if you slow it down a little bit, you're more accurate, but it actually enables you to be quicker because you're playing it better. So we expected that with DiBernardo and hopefully having Gautreau in there at some point. And when they signed Dibinha, we were like, okay, that's who they're going to feed. In the first two games since Potter was fired and Coach Caroline took over, and I'm going to call her Coach Caroline a lot. She really didn't have a chance to do a lot of modifications to the system at that point. She just, she took over on the day he was fired. And then a couple of days later, they're playing another game, and that's just recover, get back, all that stuff. This is the first game where you could start to see her putting in new wrinkles. And I think that what you're talking about, the runner, the second runner, putting Dibinha up more as less as a false nine, that sort of thing. That's where we're going to see her style come into play. And that's, I'm kind of excited to see that over the next few weeks.
Yeah. And I think too, if you want to get into to that too, like so when we talked to her, you and I talked to her, I never made an article out of that conversation initially, but it was our first like real opportunity, both of us on Zoom. We sat and we talked with her, and I got to grill her about tactics a little bit, which is always fun for me to hear influences and stuff like that. And you know, Potter very much loved the very high pressing, go forward type quick people, like a Mauricio Pochettino was one of someone. He was a Tottenham guy, and at the time Tottenham played good soccer. They don't anymore. Shots to you know, West London aside, or North London aside, Caroline talked about her influences being more, and I know it's really easy to say, oh, well, I'd love to play a hybrid of Klopp and Guardiola, to, you know, masterful tacticians. But I think there are some principles in the back three, in the way that the team was playing with the back three today, yesterday, some principles in there of the counter-pressing. So what they were doing in swarming Gotham in that second half, the counter-pressing and the balls in behind from the sharp angles and stuff like that, especially when Michelle Cooper came on, that was very Klopp-esque. But that idea of that, well, it's the way the Dibinha goal, the near side runner runs in, pulls the team back. Then as the run doesn't get played because they let that player go offside, the line drops, and whoever was playing the deepest lying center back for Gotham dropped with the line, and there's now this giant gap, and Dibinha makes the run, ball comes over the top to Dibinha, goes through. That is quintessential Pep Guardiola, like how to get teams in a mid block that are playing a mid block, like what Gotham were, out of that mid block, and how to play him over the top. And it creates those scenarios that we saw in that game. And it was so, as I was thinking afterwards, and I went back and rewatched the game, like that, those were the two things that I noticed were when she talked to us about tactics and those principles and those things that she likes, those are two very clear type of things, where high pressing teams in their defensive third, to try and turn the ball over, and then that mid block solution was very Pep-esque. So I'm curious too, because Gotham are a different opponent than like that. They've got a lot of talent. Okay, that's a very good team. Yasmin Ryan was dangerous. Lynn Williams was dangerous. If Midge Purse had been there, Midge Purse would have been incredibly dangerous. Abby Smith was fantastic the entire game except for the goal. Just unreal save after unreal save. But that second goal, I think she got just too ahead of herself to get out there and go for that ball. But ultimately, I think, not every team has that firepower like Gotham does, and some teams play a different style. It's going to be interesting this week, as they go into LA. LA does not play like Gotham plays. So how does that, how do they adjust? Do they look more like that counter-pressing team, or are they a more of a possession team in this match against Angel City? It'll be really interesting to see if she flips between those two kind of styles, based on opponents as you go forward. Because with a roster as deep as the current have, I think there's a lot of solutions and different ways that they can play based on opponent that don't necessarily like abandon their identity or abandon, who they are as a team.
Well, you say they're so deep, but I don't actually feel they're that deep right at the moment just because of all those
Correct.
injuries.
Correct.
I mean, we don't have any timeline on when Desiree Scott will be back or Morgan Gautreaux, or Alex Loetta, or I'm pretty sure that the next two back will be Elizabeth Ball and Kristen Hamilton. They have done some stuff. And then you also have Hannah Glass, who we don't, I mean, we've heard Midsummer, but which I actually kind of felt like she was closer to coming back because I see her out there doing more stuff than a lot of the other players. So we'll see about that also. So they're not really super deep at the moment. I mean,
No.
you only really have one defender sitting on the bench when they're playing. And I mean, this
Yes.
last week it was Izzy Rodriguez.
And Jenna Weinbrenner.
Oh yeah, sorry. Sorry, I apologize. Yeah, too. Because I was thinking when she was out for the COVID. I apologize.
Yes.
But you have those two. And I feel like that's something that we really need to also mention in these three games is they've had basically three very young players playing. Croy Soto, Gabrielle Robinson, and Addison Merrick. I mean, your second. Well, going into her third year, Addison Merrick is the experienced one back there on that back line of three right now.
And Gabrielle has gotten better every single game. And so we, the end of Brussels, I don't know what the results will be. And so at some point they'll come out. But for player of the month for April, including the last, the first week of matches in March, I put in there for my rookie of the month to be Gabrielle, just because of the significant growth that we got over the last couple of games from her, and that she out I mean outside of I will say Sophia Smith didn't really pick on her when Portland was in town. She was picking more so on Merrick and Weinbrenner,
Especially Jenna.
and especially Jenna. And she handled Caroline did not score. She was dangerous, but she did not score, and she held her in check for the most part. And I don't know that I would consider any of the goals that came in against them in Chicago on her necessarily either. So I think she's been really stellar. And the last couple of games, we've really gotten to see her as a back, like she is a right-footed female Andre Fontes. When she gets the ball, she's
He's
willing to,
faster than that, man.
she's fast. She might be faster than Andrea Fontes. And I love Fonte, a nice guy, a really
Yeah,
wonderful guy,
love
but
Fonty.
she might be faster than him. And but she has the vision. She has the ability to split lines with passes. She doesn't, I haven't seen her like whip out the big diagonal ball, but when you play with a back three, you don't really need to do that. You can just kind of shuttle it along and go. But she is really, really calm and comfortable on the ball for a rookie. And credit to the fact that she was a bit of a defensive midfielder at times in college as well. She's kind of played all over the field, but she's so calm with the ball at her feet, and she's a very modern attack forward-minded center back, and she's been good. Croy has handled everything well so far. I've been impressed with her. I think there are a couple of times that were a little nervy, like when Lynn Williams picked her pocket there, and I think there's a couple of passes that she's misplayed that have been a little bit difficult. But ultimately, she has started three games at the professional level and has three clean sheets when she started at the professional level. But Addison Merrick for me is one that I think she's a really good defender, and I think sometimes, obviously she had the mistake in the championship game, but she was really good down the stretch for that team through the playoff run. And I think, part of playing players to get experience is they are going to make those mistakes on occasion. And, I think she's handled it really well. So those three at the back line have been really good. I just, every single game, I feel like I am more and more impressed with Gabrielle Robinson. And she might, like I said, she got my vote for Rookie of the Month. I didn't necessarily put her on the defenders in the starting 11 per se. Just because there's some other teams that have much better defensive records in general. But
And much more experienced, but yeah.
and there's names that go with it as well. But sooner or later, she's going to be a name. Nobody really knew who Naomi Girma was after the first month or two, after the
Right.
first month. But it was 2 or 3 months after that, and people said, "Oh, snap, this girl is really good." And I just wonder if we're going to be having that conversation in a couple of months about Gabrielle.
Yeah, I don't know. That's a really interesting comparison there, man. I will need to think about that a little bit more. I have been very impressed with actually all three of those that we've been talking about here this last couple games, and none of them have been perfect, but I don't expect two rookies to be perfect at this point. And I actually was just working on photos before we started this pod, and I'm looking at a picture of Merrick knocking the ball away from Smith as she's trying to come towards the box right now. That's up on my other screen. She did a couple of very nice, touch the ball away from her, from Williams, and to, keep to make it more safe. The play still went on, but it to made it more safe, and then for the other the rest of the defense to react. So all three of them have been really impressed, but just for Croy and Gabrielle to be rookies and being thrown in this early has just I'm just very high on them at the moment to be a good pair for going forward.
You think too, like we don't have Luetta or Elizabeth Ball in the mix
Right.
too for this discussion yet, and that turns out to be a pretty deep position now, that especially if Gabrielle continues at the trajectory and Croy as well that we've seen of these first couple of games, they've handled those moments really well, and for the most part really well, have mitigated any serious threats. I think there was, Gotham certainly had their chances in this game. They were over an expected goal in that match. I think there's a couple of very helter sk they have been very good at scramble defending as
Right.
well, which I think is it helps when you're young because you have the pace to scramble defend and recover and do a lot of that. But in terms of their positioning and stuff like that, for the most part, they're not opening themselves up to other dangerous things. Like when they were up 2-0, I thought the game was over. I didn't think that the Gotham from that point on were doing anything to really threaten them. And I think it was very clear that that group was going to see that game out to a clean sheet at that point. So I it's one of those where it'll be, I will always be curious to see what happens when more players come back into the mix. But at the same time, like all three of them absolutely deserve their flowers right now.
Absolutely. All right. I don't think there will be any new players coming into the lineup for this weekend, so we'll probably go with a very similar group Now it's been interesting. This last game, they started Larson and brought Cooper off the bench, and the little bit of change there definitely helped. I don't think it was because Larson was doing anything wrong. It's just that it was a little bit different look for him, and they put a little different tactic to it, but their possession became better. It was a game that they won, that they had the low end of possession, but over two goals, expected goals to Gotham's one expected.
I thought that team should have scored. I thought the Current should have scored at least four goals in that game with the chances they had in the first half. And I don't want it to be like one of those things where, like, well, they should have. I mean, there were some really darn good opportunities that they had. And Abby Smith was incredible in goal for Gotham in that match, as we mentioned. But, they probably could have scored more. But it's one of those things for the next match. It'll be interesting. I think we'll point out that Caroline mentioned that Mimi was only on 45 minutes. They had a bit of a minutes restriction on her because she'd be coming back from a hamstring injury and had barely played more than like 30 minutes total since the Chicago game. So I think they were doing their best to be careful there and not overexert. And also, if you can throw young legs like Cooper in there to hassle and press the Gotham back line in the way that she did, but also her hold up play and ability to bring in others that created a lot of those goals, and especially, you know, the run that she made to get around Abby Smith and play that ball to the back post that eventually fell to Dabinia for the second goal. And that was all hustle plays. I wouldn't say I don't know that Mimi makes those plays, but those are the plays that you expect a very hustle minded rookie to be making. And I think that that's one of those things that aspect of Cooper really changed it. So it'll be interesting if maybe they say, based on the way San Diego defends, does she need Mimi more so, more technical player, right, as she mentioned? Her strong suit is not what Michelle's is. So it'll be interesting.
Well, that's why you have different players with different abilities, so that you can play them in different ways. That's some coaches want to have their two number nines be essentially the same player, just one a little bit better or more in form. Mm-hmm. I like having ones that are different so that you can have, and that goes to every other position, so you can have a different look when you need it to be different. All right. I don't know that I really feel like I can truly preview the next game right at the moment. I mean, we know who it is. We know that they're really good. It should be a really interesting game, but I don't think I could really go in depth of like how I want to get through this week and go to training and talk to coach and see how that goes. So I don't know if we'll have time for a second one this week. Probably not.
But we'll see. I'm with you on that. I need to watch some more San Diego as well. Rev up the Paramount Plus engine and pop on a game and take a look and see what they've been doing, because they've been playing well, getting their results as well. So,
yeah, I don't know if we're recording this on Monday night. There'll be a press availability Tuesday morning at 7 in the morning at the new stadium, because they're adding grandstand, something part of the grandstand in. Are you going to that?
Yes, I will not be, just because it's so early in the morning and I have to deal with a child with daycare. It's just a little too difficult for me, but someone will
understand.
Be there from the start.
I feel like when they did the pillar, the first beams going upright, I arrived and there's already four of them up. And I'm like, why weren't we here for the first one? They said, well, the first one went up at 7 in the morning. Who's going to be here at 7 in the morning? I said, well, I would have been. So now I feel like I got to be there for them. So I may have put my own foot in my mouth, and now I have to go. So
sounds hot. Sounds like it.
But I will probably see you at sporting training, and then current training on Wednesday, and
more sporting stuff on Thursday, and more current stuff on Friday, and then game on Sunday. Actually, both road games. Friday. There's nothing on Friday.
No.
So far.
So far. Okay.
So far. Yeah. So far, nothing's on Friday.
That could change at any moment.
Let's hope it doesn't. No. All right.
All right. appreciate the time. We were missing having Jillian on tonight. She's her other job requires her to be up really early in the morning at times. So
even earlier than you have to be there to get up from the stadium grandstand thing. So
yeah, if I got to be there at 7, I'm probably waking up at like 6:30, like,
yep,
walking out the door. So, you know,
good luck. Anyways.
All right, let's wrap it up. And any quick last words?
I've talked enough.
All right, man. I think we are out.